This video is for sections 30 and 31 of Hansen and Quinn's Greek and Intensive course and covers the subjunctive active. Hansen and Quinn cover this material on pages 63 and 65 and again on pages 654 and 658. When you first learned about Greek verbs way back in Unit 2, we talked about how we look at five things in a verb form: tense, mood, voice, person, and number. As a review, Greek regularly uses six different tenses: present, imperfect, future, aorist, perfect, and pluperfect. You've now met all of those tenses in the indicative mood. Greek also regularly uses the subjunctive mood, our topic in this video, the optative, and the imperative. You've also started learning about infinitives, and there will be, in your near future, participles. Greek has three voices: active, the one we've done so far, in which the subject of the verb is doing the action of the verb. Greek also has middle and passive, and we'll learn about those later. You also know all about Greek's first, second, and third person, and the Greek has singular, dual, and plural numbers, but that we don't use dual very much. All the verbs you've done so far are in the indicative mood. We use them for statements of fact, or things we know to be true, as well as for questions. But much of what we say, if you think about it, is not a statement of fact, so we'll need non-indicative moods. Our first will be subjunctive. Everything Greek uses the subjunctive for is non-factual, but it's used for so many different things you can't translate it until you know what kind of clause it's in. Unit 3 will give you your first use, clauses that indicate purpose, but there will be many more. You'll learn the default translations with the different types of clauses instead of with the verb forms. Subjunctive comes in all three voices, all three persons, and all numbers. But it doesn't have imperfect, future, or pluperfect tenses. It does have perfect, but it's rare enough for us not to bother with it. So we'll only be learning present and aorist tenses. With a subjunctive, tense is only about aspect, not about time. So let's get down to the nitty-gritty about how to form the present subjunctive active. Everything present comes from the first principal part, and we'll need endings to show person and number. So here's luo, and it's six principal parts, and we need principal part one. Now, to get the stem, we take that principal part and take off the omega, and we have lu. Now that we need the endings and a chart to put them in, singular and plural, first, second, and third person. And here are the endings of the singular: o, ace, a, omen, ata, osi. The third plural can also have a new movable. Accent is recessive. I can't give you a default translation because we don't have any context or know what kind of clause we're using it in. But the aspect of the subjunctive, present, is progressive repeated. Now before we go on, look at these endings and notice that they're a bit familiar. Compare the second person singular with the present indicative second person singular, ace. The eta iota subscript in the subjunctive ending is a lengthening of the diphthong in the indicative ending. The epsilon becomes eta and the iota becomes subscript. The same thing is true in the third person singular. You remember the first person plural ending amen, lengthen the omicron, and you get the omega of the subjunctive ending. In the second person plural, that epsilon in the indicative ending gets lengthened to the eta in the subjunctive ending. And even in the third person plural, the omega of the subjunctive, it's lengthened from the omicron in the indicative ending. The upsilon just factors out. You can even look at the first person singular and that omega, which would be longer if it could be, but you can't lengthen an omega any longer than it is. So one thing you can know now is that you can count on the subjunctive endings, on any subjunctive endings, to be characterized by long vowels. They'll have the person markers you recognize. Okay, enough with the linguistic backstory. Let's make some present subjunctive active verbs. We're going to need principal part one, endings, recessive accent, and a chart to put it in. So let's get the principal part. And here we have Luo's first principal part stem and all of the persons and numbers filled in. Now we need endings. And they are oase, a, omen, ate, osi, or osen. Notice how I make a clear distinction between omen of the indicative and omen of the subjunctive, and between ete of the indicative and ate of the subjunctive that you hear here. Now, we need recessive accent. You have done enough recessive accent now that I can leave off going through it step by step. Just remember that you look at the last syllable, and if it's long, you put an acute over the second to last, and if it's short, you put an acute over the third to last. In these examples, it just so happens that the singular of the subjunctive all have long last syllables, and so the singular all have an acute over the second to last, and the plural of the subjunctive all have short last syllables, and so we get an acute over the third to last. At this point in all of the indicative and infinitive videos, I've given you a default translation. But because subjunctive can do so many things, depending on the kind of clause it's in, there is no default translation I can give you now. You'll learn how to translate it as you learn each kind of clause. Person and number still functions the same way. In the singular, I, you, he, she, or it, and in the plural, we, y'all, and they. So let's try it with another verb. Here's Paideia's six principal parts for educate. We go to the first, and without the omega, we put it in, paideo, and then we add the ending and the recessive accent, paideo, but I can't give you a translation. As you can see, this form is exactly the same as the present indicative active. Context will have to tell you whether it's indicative or subjunctive, and don't worry, most of the time it will. So let's do the rest of the forms. Paideoes, paideoe, paideoomen, stem, ending, accent, paideoete, and paideoosi. Again, I can't translate any of that without the context to let you know how to use it. So that's the present subjunctive active. Let's move on to the aorist subjunctive active. As for everything else, aorist and active, we use the third principal part. And we'll add endings to show person and number. So here's Luo and the third principal part. To get our stem, we take off the alpha. But remember that the epsilon in the beginning is the past indicative augment, and we're doing subjunctive, not indicative anymore. And so we have to remove the epsilon before we have our stem to use for the subjunctive. So now we have our unaugmented aorist active stem loose. Let's get a chart for our endings, which are O, A's, A, omen, ate, OC, or sometimes osen. They are exactly the same as the present subjunctive active endings. They just go on a different stem. The accent is recessive. Again, we have no default translation because we have no context, but it has simple aspect because we're in the aorist. So let's put them together. Third principal part, and so we need the stem unaugmented in all of our persons and numbers. And then we need endings. O, ace, a, omen, ata, osi, or osin. Now we're going to need recessive accent. Again, I think I can trust you to do this now. So you can see here the acute goes back as far as it can on all of these forms. And we have luso, luces, luce, lusomen, luceta, lusosen. I can't give you a translation. Let's try it with another verb. Here's paideuo, educate, and its six principal parts. We go to the third, and starting it without our augment or without the alpha, we then add the ending and the accent. As you can see, this form is exactly the same as the future indicative active first person singular. Context will have to tell you whether it's future indicative or aorist subjunctive, and most of the time it does. Now for the rest of the forms. Unaugmented tense stem, paideos, plus our ending, plus our accent, paideoses. Stem, ending, accent, paideose. Stem, ending, accent, paideosomen. Stem, ending, accent, paideoseta. Excuse me, that would be better pronounced paideoseta. Paideoseta. I was a little too casual with my eta sound there. And then finally, unaugmented tense stem, ending, and accent, paideososi. And that's the aorist subjunctive active. You're now prepared, if you do your memorization, to recognize and practice those forms and to use them when you need them.